Jeremy, thank you so much for joining us here at FundForum International. A fantastic presentation about where we are in the clean energy revolution. So what are your key thoughts at this moment, at this very time that we're at? Is it an inflection point? Are we about to reach those goals you've been striving for your entire career?
Well, we're certainly getting there. In the last few years, it's been amazing to watch how fast the clean energy revolution is unfolding. Now, it would be wrong to say that we've won or are anywhere close to winning, but the very fact that so many people sat in the room, presumably representing so many billions of asset value, listening to something that, honestly, a few years ago, they'd probably have stayed in bed after the party for, that shows you where we are, where we're at. And as I said in my talk, there's this huge opportunity going forward. Hundreds of billions of dollars worth of investment will go into clean energy if the current trajectory, the current mega trend of being in compliance with the Paris Agreement of 2015 that government signed continues.
So this is no longer a nice bit of lip service for these companies. It's a real bottom line winner.
Yes, and of course I've been fortunate enough to witness that myself. I founded a solar company 20 years ago, and if I'd collected a pound for every time over most of those 20 years, I'd been told that I was a rootless dreamer and this stuff would never be cheaper than coal and gas and the rest of it, or powering electric vehicles, ha ha. You know, I'd be rich, because so many people told me that. And most of my career has been, I have had the feeling I was sort of bashing my head against a brick wall. But now, without boring you with the details, Solar Century is doing very well. A number of other solar companies are doing very well. And defenders of the energy incumbency are surprised to hear, for example, that most of the new electric power generation capacity that came on stream last year was solar, and that solar was more than all the coal, all the gas, all the oil, and all the nuclear put together.
It is extraordinary. The facts are there, the data's there now. It can't be denied.
No.
As such, are you seeing certain geographies being much more forward in this as well? And are there going to be those incumbents, as you described, who are being left behind by it?
I think the reason why it's a safe bet that this will continue is because there are multiple constituencies, and the United Nations played a great role between 2009 and 2013 in building this. So we have hundreds of cities going gangbusters on a low carbon future. We have many of the world's biggest corporations doing a terrific job of leading from the front in deploying renewables right across their global activities. And of course, many of the governments have played a very strong game, including France, Germany, China, India, and until relatively recently, of course, the United States as well.
So you mentioned Mr. Trump there. What effect do you think he will have long term?
Well, of course, he's going to slow things down and he's going to create problems, but he's not going to derail it. And you see the way he's struggling to fulfill his promises to the beleaguered coal workers in America. And it's not surprising, because, you know, it's becoming cheaper in some places to build new solar plants than it is to run existing coal plants. And in Kentucky and other places, new solar, battery, wind power companies are employing coal miners, out-of-work coal miners. They've got complementary skills. It's like King Canute trying to stand in the way of the tide. He's just not going to do it.
And as you say, those workers can have transferable skills into the renewable market anyway.
Exactly so. And that's, I think, particularly clear in the offshore oil and gas industry, where those skills are often, the engineering skills are often brilliantly suited to the fast emerging wind industry.
You mentioned China briefly a moment ago. What's your view on what position they're at in terms of leading this?
Well, on the whole, they're playing a very good game. And let's not forget that they are fantastically motivated here. And the Chinese leadership is very technically literate in their education. So when their scientists tell them that climate change, if we leave climate change untended, we are going to lose the Chinese economy. The Chinese economy is located on the coastal plain. It will go, and it will go this century. It's that severe a threat. And on top of that, of course, you've got air pollution. And anyone who's been to China and breathed the air in Chinese cities knows this is a really acute problem, and millions of people are dying prematurely because of it. So they're very motivated to make the energy transition, and they're real leaders in it as a result of what they've done over the last few years, scaling up their manufacturing and everything else. But even they can go further and faster. And I think one of the worries is that, you know, they saw the impact of working together in the run-up to the Paris Climate Summit with the Americans as closely as they did. This has never happened in history before. It was though they were both on the same side. From 2013 through 2015, they were a double act. And that dragged the rest of the world along, you know, with them. So we're in danger of losing that with all this ridiculous Trump talk about trade wars and wars and everything else.
So geopolitics does have an effect, but it could hopefully be a short term one in that sense.
Yes.
So that's China. Obviously, other emerging markets are perhaps in a position where they don't have to retrofit stuff, and they can leapfrog many of the old incumbents and go for the new.
They'll have to. And, you know, even the World Bank is saying that. So the notion of building a massive central coal-fired power plant in any East African country and extending the grid is ridiculous. I mean, it would just be fabulously more expensive than the new options. And we see this on the front lines as well in solar centuries. So we're building little mini grids and hybrids. Solar power plants where, you know, you have your solar, you have your batteries, and, you know, if you're worried about the reliability or you want to, you can use your diesel, but you never have to, and it's too expensive to do that anyway. So, you know, you can smell what's coming. We have a saying that seeing is believing, and we've experienced this all the way through the 20 years of the company's history. You know, people have a look at a solar roof tile and think, that doesn't work, does it? I mean, look, it's just... How does that work? And then they connect it in, and sure enough, it works. It works really well, even under cloudy skies. And so you get this constituency of people who progressively see that the world can be fueled a different way, a completely different way. And then all the other slipstream benefits start kicking in. You're producing your energy at home. You don't have to go and fight wars in the Middle East for it all, and et cetera, et cetera.
It could have a real impact on global cohesion
socially,
for that reason.
Exactly. Exactly. And that's, you know, one of the reasons that people like me, who are not business people in our blood, have been attracted into the industries.
Now, the people you were speaking to today are business people,
yes,
in their blood. And how do you appeal to them, and what do you present to them as the opportunity in this now?
Well, this is the beauty of it. I mean, you know, one of the slides I showed, and, you know, anyone can view it on my website, is the cost down. It's the economics. I don't have to talk to them like an environmental campaigner. I can talk to them for the full half hour as though, you know, here is the opportunity, guys. And by the way, look at the alternatives. You want risk? You want to take some risks? Carry on investing in coal, oil, and gas. So it feels, I have to say, you know, it, after all these years of trying, it feels very good at the moment.
And you'll be pleased to hear that ESG was very much on top of the agenda here this week. And partly because these companies are recognising that perhaps new investors and the millennial generation actually want to feel their money's doing good.
And that's one of the beauties. Another slide I showed was of the biggest opinion poll in multiple countries, 20-odd countries, thousands and thousands of people, you know, and they're asked the question, should the world be fully powered by renewable energy? And 83% of them said yes. And, you know, that's Republicans and Democrats, that's people who vote Labour and Conservative. You know, it's not a party political issue at all now. It's this makes sense. This is how we're going to get returns on our investment. Let's go this route.
So if any CEO in the room that was listening to you at this conference takes any one thing home with them that you have to say, what would you hope it would be?
Well, if they're in oil and gas, be very careful, because this isn't just about economics. This is about liability. And in the law courts right now, cities, companies, individuals, school children are taking these companies to court, accusing them of a range of crimes, from securities fraud right through to murder, first degree murder, knowingly keeping going and defending the status quo. I'm not, you know, saying that this is right. I'm just saying, you know, don't shoot the messenger here. I'm just reporting what's happening in the courtrooms of the world. And so I would say to, and I do say to leaders in the oil and gas industry, be very careful. You may not enjoy your retirement.
So this could be the ultimate global sin stock, is what you're talking about.
Yes, and that is the proposition that is being tested in multiple courtrooms right now.
Jeremy, it's an incredibly exciting moment. It's great to hear your insights. Thank you so much for joining us at FundForum.
Thank you.